What's up, game devs? In today's video, we're going to set up a simple drag and drop system that works on both mobile and desktop and allows you to have multiple draggable items on the screen. I will follow up with another video to also add some convenience features, such as snapping inside another item if the drop is valid, going to the starting position if the drop is not valid, and avoid overlapping items by repositioning in the closest valid position. If you're interested in the second part, feel free to hit the subscribe button to get notified when it will be out. Anyway, I'm planning to do that probably next week, so stay tuned. With that said, let's begin with the first part and drag this video to the action. First of all, we need a sprite that will be our draggable item. And we can already create a new script called Draggable. We also need to assign this item a collider, and I'll explain why later. For now, the script will be pretty much empty, and we're only gonna use it to recognize if an item can be dragged or not. More code will be added here in the next video for the three additional features. With that done, we can create an empty game object in the hierarchy and work on the core logic that will be the drag controller script. We put a bool flag isDragActive that indicates if there's one item in the scene that is currently being dragged. Let's also add a vector2 called screenPosition that will be the coordinates of our input. WorldPosition will be a vector3 expressed in world coordinates for our effective final position in the game. Finally, we add here a last drag item that is the reference of the last draggable item we moved. Now that we have our prior fields, we can get rid of start and define the main functions that are initDrag, drag, and drop. Before moving to the update function though, we might want to add awake here. Awake is called by Unity before start, and we're gonna use it to make sure that there is only one drag controller in the scene. We can do that by looking for all existing drag controller items and check if the length of the list equals to 1. As this function runs inside a drag controller, if it only finds one item, it means it's the right one. If it finds more, it means that this item can be destroyed, as it would be a duplicate. Okay, we can now start writing the logic for catching the player's input. As we want this to work on both mobile and desktop, we're gonna listen for a mouse click first, and then for a single touch on the screen. If none of those is detected, we can already return, as there's nothing to drag here. Otherwise, we continue and convert the 2D touched position on the screen to world coordinates. If we are already in drag mode, we just call drag. Else, we have to detect the item we want to move, and we can begin our drag. To let the script know if we clicked or touched on a draggable item on the screen, we can cast a 2D ray on the world position with vector2.0 as direction. What this does is basically looking at what is on the screen at the given position. If the ray collides with an item, and that item has our draggable component, we can store it on the last drag and call our initDrag. Don't forget that this only works if your item has a collider. What's left? Oh yeah, the drop function. Let's get back to the beginning of our update for a moment. We can check here if we're in drag mode and we want to drop, that is when the mouse goes up, or we have one touch and the touch phase equals to touch phase.ended. Here we call drop and return. If you find the if condition a bit confusing because of all the brackets, you can nest the two ifs like that. What happens is the same. At this point, it's finally time to define what our three core methods should do. Don't worry, the coding part for the basic implementation is almost done. So, initDrag sets the drag bool to true, so that in the update function we call the right methods. Drag, as the name suggests, updates the transform.position of our last dragged item with a new vector too, indicating the work position of our mouse or finger on the screen. The value of work position comes from the update method when we read the input. Finally, drop sets our isDragged to false, so that our item will no longer follow the mouse or the finger. And that's it for the first part. In case you're wondering why we use two methods to just switch a bool flag, well, it is always a good practice to split the logic in main methods, and this will also come handy on the second part of the video, where we'll add more logic in there. We can finally jump to the editor and see that we can drag our items and drop them wherever we want. Like I mentioned in the beginning, I'm also going to show you how to handle if a drop is valid or not, and reposition the item accordingly. For example, if you're moving something inside a slot, you may want it to be snapped in the middle. If you want to avoid items to be overlapping, we can reposition the dragged one automatically, or if you just want to entirely cancel the drag and make the item smoothly go back on the previous position, we're gonna see how to do that as well. Feel free to subscribe to the channel to get notified when the second part of this video will be out, and also enjoy the other game dev content like this one. Done? Great! Now that you are subscribed, you can see floating on the screen some more videos you might enjoy. Feel free to give them a look and let me know in the comments if you have any feedback. Thanks for watching, have fun with your new drag and drop system, and see you soon!